Merlin.
The start of Merlin Series 3 kicks off with a bit of an exciting start. Again, set a year in the future, a lot has happened within that year.
Oh God.
We don't know exactly what, so everything pretty much kicks off and gets into a very dramatic stage within kind of the first 5 minutes of the episode. And of course, evil things are afoot, particularly with Morgana. So we end up with a highly dramatic sequence at the end with the dragon finally coming to help Merlin in a way. We think the dragon's been gone from the last series, but Merlin has acquired the powers of the dragon lord and summons his old friend to come back and help him, which he does.
Oh, dragon!
And a real cliffhanger at the end. Merlin's taken off. Where's he taken to? Where's he gone? What's going to happen when he's there? That's all to come.
Merlin.
One of the highlights from episode 2 for me was definitely riding the dragon.
I've no intention of walking.
Which looks quite good when it's finished, but the actual filming of it and how we did it is anything but magical. We was actually on one of those bucking broncos that you see where people get bucked off them. So that's basically what I was on. That's what the dragon was for me. But seeing it in the episode obviously looks completely different once the guys at the mill get their hands on it. It looks fantastic. Another highlight from the episode was definitely getting to fight the skeletons, because Jason the Argonauts is a big childhood film for me. I loved it. And to get the scripts and go Merlin fights the skeletons, I was like, yes! And getting a chance to do this was a bit of a childhood dream. So yeah, all exciting to see it all finished.
Merlin.
Episode 3, Goblin's Gold. Is an episode where everyone kind of steps out of character for a while. You've gone into a bit of a farcical, melodramatic type situation in which Gaius gets possessed by a goblin. And everyone, all characters kind of buy into this kind of sub-reality, so everyone's not quite themselves, because it's a weird episode. When I watch it, I kind of get that impression from it, and which is great, but to hilarious effect. So you've got Richard Wilson putting in a fantastic performance, being possessed by this gold-licking goblin, which, when not inside Gaius, is a goblin, which is voiced by Mark Williams. And I actually got to be there whenever Mark was doing the voice for the goblin.
Boo!
They actually used his facial movements for it as well. They did the face mapping for that and actually used all his facial expressions. There was many a noise he experimented with whenever the goblin turned into the ball of light. One of my particular favourites that he did was I think it ended up being just like a but whenever we were doing it, he did one where he just randomly started going
there, where, here, there, where, here, there, no, here, where,
and he went on for like ages and it was cracking me up. I was just sitting there, you know, and but I think he did a fantastic job on it, and it's a hilarious episode.
Merlin.
Owen Macken, who plays Gwen, is just fantastic. He's a great guy, great actor. He brings a lot of charm and humour to the character of Gwen.
What do they call you then? Merlin. Gwen. Pleasure to meet you. Such a waste, huh?
Which is quite a famous character from the Legends, so it's great to see him, as the show does quite a lot, is take the Legends and show them in a new and interesting way. And Gwen's this noble guy, but hates nobility as it is in Camelot. He's noble for his own reasons, and he's very strong-minded in that.
Arthur.
Prince Arthur, you saved his life.
I don't know who he was. I probably wouldn't have.
And Merlin sees something he can connect with there, and it's great. I love the episodes where Merlin gets a friend and who doesn't die. So it's great that Merlin and Gwen, they have this relationship with their fathers.
My father was a knight in Colin's army. He died in battle, leaving my mother penniless. And when she went to the king for help,
You turned her away.
You didn't know him?
Just some stories I've been told.
Yeah, I know how that feels.
And the fathers is kind of a running theme for Merlin, and this seems to prop up quite a lot, and it does in this episode with Gwen. So hopefully he'll come back and they can hang out a bit more. Well, this is my favourite episode of the series. It's the Crystal Cave is an element of Arthurian legend that I've loved, and I've been dying to see it brought into the series.
What is this place?
This is where magic began. It is the Crystal Cave.
In a really great way, it's that time-old dilemma of not being able to stop the future. It's inevitable. And Merlin thinks he can. He sees these visions of Morgana killing Uther, and he goes about stopping that. And at one point in the episode, he believes that he has, but the future cannot be altered. Or if it is, it's done in a wrong way.
Yeah. It's just what every woman wants, isn't it?
And it's a kind of race against time. It turns into this a dramatic adventure, I think, for Merlin psychologically, as to how he can try and stop the future. And it becomes about others for him. It becomes about others' emotions and upset, and he can't see that happen. But yeah, again, it just becomes evident he can't change the future. One of the huge revelations, obviously, in this episode is that Morgana is Uther's daughter.
I know she's dear to you, sir, but surely you're not going to risk everything for Morgana.
Morgana is my daughter.
I mean, this changes everything for Merlin. I mean, if she was to die, it would change the future in the wrong way. That's all he wanted to do. He wanted to change the future, but he didn't want to see this happen. And to have her gone, and it doesn't fit in with the jigsaw of a happy future. And Merlin goes about to change this. We constantly see Merlin ignoring the advice of the dragon. So in this episode, he commands him. He tells him this is the way it has to be. He uses, I guess, his ability as a dragon lord, that he has power now over the dragon. It's a new sort of way in their relationship, although he's ignoring his advice as such.
To change the future is no simple matter, Merlin. To do so is fraught with danger.
He does take it on board. But I think now Merlin very much realizes he can say the way it has to be, and the dragon kind of has to take his advice.
Merlin.
Yeah, this has definitely been one of the best comedy trios that we've had on the show, with the characters of Gunhilda and Princess Elena and her father. Who arrive in Camelot, and it's an arranged wedding for Arthur, but with a difference. You've got this Princess Lena with a pixie inside her that leaves her clumsy and all over the place. This was a great episode of film. We had Miriam Margulies playing Gunhilda, who is a bit of a comedy genius, and her and Richard Wilson together in their scenes, I think, are some of the best things in the series.
You don't fool me for one minute. You were looking for me.
I was?
I understand. It's all right.
I think probably I should be going.
Why don't we make sweet perfume together?
She genuinely, for me, was laugh out loud. And Miriam herself on set was a constant joy, I know, for both cast and crew. So everyone enjoyed having her around. And yeah, that's definitely, that was one of the, when I think of the highlights of the series, there's definitely some days there which went by very quickly with a lot of laughter.
Merlin.
What's great is in this episode we focus a bit on Gwen's past, and that is told through her brother and the loyalty that there is between a brother and sister.
Why have you brought me to this place?
I have a guest. I thought you might like to meet him.
That's really contrasted with the disloyalty that you have with her friend, supposedly Morgana, who is kind of set this whole thing up.
Is everything in place? Arthur's taken the bait. So he means to rescue her brother, just as we thought. There is nothing he would not do for her. Excellent.
Merlin gets very quickly on the trail with this, and this is a real marker, I think, in the maturity level for Merlin, that he latches onto this so quickly, and he's on the ball. He's right in there to thwart her plans, which very quickly falls through.
Leg.
Can you walk?
No, it's your ankle. You need to rest it.
I don't have that kind of time.
We can't go on without her.
What other choice do we have?
No, no, it's all right. I can go on.
No, you can't. You'll only make it worse.
I said I'm fine.
Yeah, we're seeing Tom Ellis return and Amelia Fox, which are the two consistent baddies of the series, who are constantly, as evident from the first two episodes, are planning stuff right throughout this series.
Don't worry about me.
I don't. Believe me.
And I thought you cared.
I care only that Morgana takes her rightful place upon the throne of Camelot.
I share that desire, Morgos.
Of course you do. After all, you stand to gain much from Arthur's death.
I don't deny it, but I'm rich and powerful already. I do this only to please you.
Then please me.
I think they're a great, formidable duo together. There's a kind of there's a good chemistry between them, which they, I know that they both relish in when playing those parts, and it's definitely very telling for what's to come for the both of them in the future.
Merlin.
This episode is again one of my favourites. It's a great adventure. It reminds me of one of those great 80s adventures style movies, and of course it features a character from one of those great 80s adventure movies, Willow, with his Warwick Davis, and that was definitely a huge highlight. Probably my favourite guest star of the series, I'd say, and he is the keeper of the bridge.
Who is it that wishes to cross my bridge?
Knight. On a quest to find the trident of the Fisher King.
He wards the divide between this world and the perilous lands.
There is nothing to be afraid of. Your presence is essential if Arthur is to succeed on his quest.
How do you know about Arthur? Who are you?
The keeper of the bridge.
And it was great to have him on the show. He's such a huge, huge part of the legacy that is Willow. And now he's part of a legacy that is Merlin.
Merlin.
There's a huge mystery around Gaius's past, and we don't know a lot about his past at all, really, as we don't about Merlin's. But in this episode, we get a glimpse of an emotional side of Gaius, that he had a love that was lost and now is back. But this is a villain with a twist in this episode. This is a villain that we've never quite seen before, because Pauline Collins is under control of this manticore creature.
You must put aside your feelings and do what needs to be done.
What kinds of magic did she practice?
All kinds. It's a time of experimentation, learning.
Right. What about dark magic?
And it was actually a lot of fun filming the manticore scenes whenever it attacks me, because when I watch it back, I think it looks great. But in actual fact, I had a big blue beanbag, which I was manipulating, trying to create the movements of the manticore, and that was a lot of fun to film. The episode as a whole, I think, is a great emotional journey. It's the first time we ever see Merlin and Gaius fall out.
I can see perfectly well, Merlin, and what I can see is that you cannot bear for me to be happy. I cannot begin to guess why that should be. But it saddens me more than I can say.
It's the very first time we see that, and I think it's a great milestone in their relationship that they overcome that. But it's also a sad note for Gaius, because he loses her once again.
Merlin.
This episode highlights the depths Morgana's willing to sink to infiltrate the throne.
You cannot allow this serving girl to take your rightful place upon the throne.
And her friendship, she's willing to really ruin that all.
Arthur!
And to break the bonds between father and son.
You have to see reason. Guinevere has done nothing wrong.
She has been found guilty of using magic and enchantments. She will be burnt at the stake.
No.
Restrain him!
You can't do this!
And although this episode has that very dark motives in there, it also has the contrast elements of the love between Arthur and Guinevere, which is great to see them now pursuing that so secretively but openly to themselves. And it's great for Merlin to see that. But the highlight of this episode for me was to get the chance to play the old Merlin, which was great. For 3 years, you know, almost 3 years now, playing Merlin, it was good to do something completely different and to spend those sort of 6 hours in prosthetics getting made up to be 80 years old.
Oh, yeah. I ache all over.
Well, now you know how I feel.
It was totally worth it to spend a day walking around freaking people out. I actually went around, there was a stage of the prosthetics where I don't have a wig on and I'm bald and I'm actually quite scary looking, and I enjoyed walking around freaking people out. I remember knocking on Angel's door one day and just people coming around the corner going boo as the old man, and she was freaked out for the rest of the day. So a lot of fun was had with that.
Merlin.
I've read the Harry Potter books, and I've seen the films. I like the darker tones that the movies take, and to have Harry Melling in the show is great. I think him and me, particularly on the very last day of filming, the very last day of series 3, all our big scenes were all on that day, so we knew the pressure was on and we had to do them and we had to deliver.
Merlin, that's me.
I'm Gilly. I gotta go.
That was great that we had that concentrated time for the whole day to do those. And I think he's great in the episode. And I think it's also good to see Merlin in that advisor type role.
You saved my life, and I'm trying to save yours. You need to withdraw from the tournament.
It's an open competition. You're supposed to be able to use whatever skills you have.
Fighting skills. You're not a swordsman or a gladiator. Fighting is not your talent. Magic is.
Then why can't I use it?
Because it's banned.
Without magic, I'm a nobody.
We've seen Merlin so much as the one who is seeking advice, and now he sees one very much like himself 3 years ago.
It's lonely. Be more powerful than any man you know and have to live like a shadow. To be special and have to pretend you're a fool. I know how it feels. I
Understand.
And he's taken on that role now, the Gaius is.
We're kin. Kin.
And I think that's, again, the maturity that we're seeing Merlin taking on is taking that one step further in this episode.
Merlin.
Morgana's character is the one that has had to make the hugest leap, I think, over the whole three series coming to this point.
The location of the cup was secret. There's only one explanation, sir. We have a traitor in our midst.
She has literally gone to the dark side. Her character has flipped completely. And for Katie herself, I think she enjoys playing the body. It's good that her and Amelia have got a really good relationship, and they're these two conniving kind of witches working together on the scheme. And obviously their motives are hugely dark.
What is it you wanted to tell me, sister?
For Merlin, that's... It's no surprise at this stage, but if you take them the way they were, I mean, they were friends to begin with, and he wanted to change her. He wanted to show her the right path, and that magic is an ability that you have, and it's how you choose to use it. She has, on more than one occasion, proved that that's not her intentions, that her path and his are not the same path, and that, in fact, their paths are in direct conflict.
I don't think you'll be needing this anymore.
This is unlawful. You cannot do this. You have no right to the throne!
No, she does not. But I do.
She's taken advantage of the fact that she's got this lineage with the throne and with the king. And that's very much, she's got her sights set on the throne, and that's where she's going to be, and that's where she is at the end of the episode as we end on that cliffhanger.
Merlin.